Welcome to worship on this first Sunday of Advent in a very unique and challenging year that is 2020. Our hope and prayer for you this year is that our Advent series will provide you with something stable and steady to rest in as we enter into a new church year and move toward the Christmas season. We've mailed out a copy of our Advent devotional guide to every household on our church mailing list. There are still some copies in the lobby at the church for those of you who might like an additional copy. Or you can also download a copy for yourself from our Advent series website, guelphsa.ca/advent2020. And the description, the link for that is in the description below. Over the course of our Advent worship, we're going to traverse familiar territory, hearing the stories that we've heard countless times over the years. Each week of Advent, we'll study one of the four gospel writers who each assume a different angle, selectively choosing which parts of the birth narrative best convey their message. Altogether, these stories form one of the essential narratives of our faith, the anticipation and arrival of the Word made flesh. Well, would you now hear our call to worship from Proverbs chapter 4, verses 25 to 27, which says, "Keep your head up, your eyes straight ahead, and your focus fixed on what is in front of you. Take care you don't stray from the straight path, the way of truth, and you will safely reach the end of your road. Do not veer off course to the right or to the left. Step away from evil and leave it behind." May God bless you as you worship with us today. Would you join me for a prayer of confession? Starting already, Lord, it's only the first Sunday in Advent and we are caught up in the pressures and stresses of the holiday season. Pursued by the temptation to spend our funds, our energy, our spirits, we feel that there's no peace or rest in the world. Lord of light and peace, shine on us this day. Forgive us when we have so easily succumbed to the anxieties and fears and temptations of the season. Slow us down. Calm our spirits. Give us an awareness that this is the season of waiting and of preparation. Pour peace into our lives and help us to be bearers of peace to others. For we ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Now, I hope you have your candles handy as we participate in the lighting of our first Advent candle, the Preparation of Peace candle.
Today is the first Sunday of Advent. Advent means coming, and in this season, we prepare for the coming of Christ. It is a time not only for remembering the coming of Christ in Bethlehem, but also for seeking to recognize him when he comes to us now. Jesus lives in our own times and in our own lives, yet too often he is a stranger to us and we fail to recognize him. We are not prepared.
By lighting one candle each week of Advent, we help ourselves get ready for the birth of Jesus. The candles have different meanings, each based upon the Bible. These meanings help us understand how special the birth of Jesus is for us. Today we focus on the candle of preparation of peace.
In the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up, every mountain and hill made low. The rough ground shall become level, the rugged places a plain. And the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all people will see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Today we light the candle of preparation of peace. Let it remind us to prepare our hearts for the coming of Christ.
Almighty God, as we begin this season of Advent, remind us again that in the midst of our darkness, you are bringing us peace to calm our anxious spirits and hectic lives. Turn our hearts again toward you. Make us ready to receive your Son, our Savior. Slow our pace and give us the blessing of feeling your peace in our spirits. For we ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Today is the first week of Advent, the 4 weeks before Christmas. For the next few weeks, we're going to talk about different parts of the Christmas story. How many of you are ready for Christmas? How many of you think your parents are ready for Christmas? What are some of the things you or your parents do to get ready for Christmas? How long does it take for them to get ready? Going all the way back to the first Christmas, when Jesus was born, there were a lot of preparations that needed to be made. What do you think had to be done to get ready for the first Christmas? God started making his preparations hundreds of years before Jesus was born. We read in the Bible that God told the prophet Isaiah that someone would shout in the wilderness that it was time to get ready for the Lord. That someone turned out to be John the Baptist, who later helped people get ready to meet Jesus. So, as we get ready for Christmas, let's remember that a long time ago, God was also getting everybody ready for the first Christmas. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, We thank you for being born as a baby a long time ago. And we thank you that your Father God helped us all get ready for that first Christmas. Bless us today. Amen. We'll see you back here next week.
Today we look at the Gospel of Mark. It's the shortest of the Gospels and widely regarded to be the first one written. Mark says nothing about the birth of Jesus. There are no angels, no shepherds, no mention of Mary or Joseph, no star, and no manger. Mark begins right off the bat with the preaching of John the Baptist, who calls people to repent. Like all the greats of history, Jesus doesn't just arrive. He is announced. And who better than John to do that?
Isaiah the prophet told us what would happen before he came. Watch, I will send my messenger in front of you to prepare your way and make it clear and straight. You'll hear him, a voice crying in the wilderness. Prepare the way of the Eternal One, a straight way in the wandering desert, a highway for our God.
That messenger was John the Baptist, who appeared in the desert near the Jordan River, preaching that people should be ritually cleansed through baptism with water as a sign of both their changed hearts and God's forgiveness of their sins. People from across the countryside of Judea and from the city of Jerusalem came to him and confessed that they were deeply flawed and needed help, so he cleansed them with the waters of the Jordan.
Someone is coming who is a lot more powerful than I am, one whose sandals I'm not worthy to bend down and untie. I've washed you here through baptism with water, but when he gets here, he will wash you in the Spirit of God.
The Jordan River is the setting of some of the most memorable miracles in the Old Testament. On their journey through the wilderness to the Promised Land, the Israelites walked across the Jordan River on dry ground because God parted its waters. Elisha, one of the prophets of God, healed Naaman by telling him to bathe 7 times in its waters. Partly because of miracles like these, and partly because of a growing wilderness spirituality, many of the Jews in John's day are out to hear him and be ritually baptized in the Jordan's cool, cleansing waters. They are looking for God to intervene miraculously in their lives, as he had done in the past. What they don't know is that God is about to intervene, for at that time, Jesus leaves Nazareth and heads south.
It was in those days that Jesus left Nazareth, a village in the region of Galilee, and came down to the Jordan, and John cleansed him through baptism there. In the same way, all the others were ritually cleansed. But as Jesus was coming out of the waters, he looked up and saw the sky split open. The Spirit of God descended upon him like a dove, and a voice echoed in the heavens.
You are my son, my beloved one, and I am very pleased with you.
By calling us to prepare the way of the Lord through John the Baptist, Mark challenges us to change our hearts and lives and make ourselves ready to receive Jesus along with everything that entails. He calls us to adopt hearts and lives characterized by a desire to follow Jesus, a willingness to suffer on account of him, and a hope in the glorious future life he has promised us.
It's hard to believe that the Advent season is already upon us. Some days it felt like it would never arrive.
But now that it's here,
kind of feels like we're not ready for it. Not yet. I mean, is it okay to celebrate? Is it okay to be happy? To decorate? To carry on as normal? Well,
we all know about normal. Normal's gone.
Even the new normal didn't last long.
Or the one after that.
No, normal has been canceled, just like everything else this year.
Travel plans, dinner guests, carol sings. None of it seems likely.
Canceling plans has become more normal than actually carrying them out.
We all hold our expectations more loosely now. Perhaps we should have been doing that already. Perhaps this year has shown us how much we take for granted.
I can't remember a Thanksgiving where I felt more genuinely thankful.
For my doctors.
For my kids' teachers. For the checker at the grocery store. For my family.
My coworkers, whom I haven't seen in months.
What I wouldn't give to hear them singing from the cubicle while I'm trying to concentrate.
Now singing, is it even safe? It's too risky.
So how can we celebrate even if we wanted to?
Joy to the world. Peace on earth.
I look around and all I see is loss.
The economy. I need to be more careful this year.
I can't afford it, but should I?
My brother lost his job.
My best friend lost her mother.
I've lost. No.
No. It's too much.
There are no words. No more tears left to cry.
How can I celebrate with such a heavy heart?
I trust that things will get better. Maybe. We hope.
But is it even safe to hope?
And hope in what? A vaccine? A cure? A rebound? That things will go back to the way that they were before?
Maybe by prom, or at least graduation. That things will at least start getting better. Eventually.
Before all of this seems so long ago.
I've had enough already. But all I keep hearing is, not yet.
What if this is actually the perfect time to celebrate Christ coming to earth? Teetering in the balance between already and not yet.
The ancient world languished between the prophecy and its fulfillment.
We languish still in the midst of the already and before and not yet.
Jesus has already come to earth, but Jesus has not yet returned. At Christmas, we celebrate his coming and anticipate it just the same.
Deliverance, healing, freedom from oppression.
These things he has already given us, and still for many, they're not yet experienced. Gifts purchased and extended, but not yet received or fully unwrapped.
Redemption is unfolding and taking hold slowly, right before our very eyes.
Too slowly for our impatient tastes.
Yet, slowly, tentatively, Christmas dares us to move forward, to be confident in things hoped for but not yet seen. To trust that God is already with us, and yes, to celebrate. Even in the midst of chaos, that hope has come already and not yet.
Over the next 4 weeks during our Advent season, we'll be surveying the four accounts of Jesus' birth from within the four Gospels. Today we begin with the Gospel of Mark, which is widely regarded to be the first Gospel written, and it's the shortest, but it turns out that Mark actually says nothing, nada, about the birth of our Christ. There are no angels, no shepherds, no mention of Mary and Joseph, no stable, nothing that we would expect to find in any Christmas play or cantata. In fact, when we first meet Messiah Jesus in Mark, he's already an adult and he's prepared to begin his earthly ministry. So why would we even include Mark's gospel in this series? Certainly doesn't sound a whole lot like Christmas. Well, that's true. But this portion does sound a whole lot like Advent. And what do I mean by this? Well, the season of Advent is both a looking forward to the return of Christ, to his second coming, as well as a remembrance of his first coming. Advent is a season where Christ's church unites universally with traditions and liturgy to refocus and renew our passionate desire and preparation of the promise and truth that Christ is coming back. He has come already, and he will return to fully establish his kingdom here on earth. Now, Mark does an amazing job helping us as believers in Christ to do both of those things, to remember and to anticipate. And these first couple of verses of Mark 1 also give us wisdom in how we are to live within this time of waiting, within these last days. And I love the irony of today's message title, Slow Down, Pay Attention. Because the entire Gospel of Mark is anything but slow. This book moves us at a fast clip through the life of Jesus. Mark's favorite word is immediately, which he uses 41 times in 16 chapters, three times as much as the other three Gospels combined. So this gives you an idea of how action-packed and paced this Gospel is. I like how Mark pulls you in right from the first words. Maybe that's also why I really enjoy the James Bond or Mission Impossible movies as well. Each of those films are fully action-packed right from the first scenes. The tone is quickly set, and these movies grab you, and they don't let you go until the end credits. Well, here in chapter 1, we have John the Baptist bursting onto the scene. He's a voice calling in the wilderness. He's grabbing our attention by reminding us as readers that a Messiah has been prophesied for generations, and that a messenger will be sent by God to prepare the way for the Lord and to make straight paths for him. And so John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, Mark 1 and 4 tells us. Yes, Mark wants to get our attention, but he also wants us to slow down a bit and pay attention to what the messenger really has to say. Because the message is a life changer. These are words that offer the hearers life through repentance. Have you ever seen the production of Handel's Messiah? It's an oratorio in three parts. It's centered on the entire life, death, resurrection, and ascension or glorification of Christ. The lyrics come directly from Scripture. You've probably heard pieces from the Messiah that are well known, especially the Hallelujah chorus at the end of part two, where often in a live performance, the audience would traditionally stand while it is sung. Well, when I was in high school, I attended a concert band, concert choir, performance of Messiah. And while watching it, I found myself, during the first couple of numbers, looking ahead on the program to see what was coming or maybe what would be familiar to. I quickly realized that I wasn't in the moment of what was being performed. I was missing the bigger picture because I was only looking ahead. I had to slow down and just simply pay attention and be present. Well, that represents how our lives often look, right? We live in such a fast-paced and instant result culture that life is constantly just passing us by. Even as believers in Christ, we find ourselves engulfed in an artificial world of our own construction, rather than a world that invites us into the mysteries of faith and being truly present within moments of trust, of seeing God's kingdom come. Even now, as we enter into this particular season of Advent, we can easily miss the amazing and beautiful opportunities to engage within our faith journey, to be challenged once again in our walk, and ready to hear a fresh perspective. We might even be saying or thinking that we're not quite ready for Christmas or Advent yet. This could mean that we're not quite ready for God to once again break into our lives and to renew us or revitalize us because we find ourselves too busy or engrossed in our own self-made world. But even if we think we are ready for Advent, we probably would naturally jump to the Gospels of Matthew and Luke anyways because we're so used to the scenes of shepherds on a hillside being visited by a chorus of angels. We're content with the story of there being no room in the inn and the Savior of the world being born in a barn and sleeping in the manger. That's our Christmas comfort zone, isn't it? But Mark allows us to not only look back to what Christ has done, but also to renew a right spirit within us for today and for our tomorrows. Advent is about getting ready for our returning Messiah. Advent is about changing our behavior and gaining a righteous life perspective today. Advent is about current forgiveness and current repentance. We've established that the first part of chapter 1 focuses on John the Baptist, the messenger of the coming Christ. All four Gospels include the story of John the Baptist, but Mark is the only one that uses the word prepare twice by quoting two prophets, Isaiah and Malachi, together in one thought. The first time we see the word prepare in Mark 1 verse 2, it's given to us from the Greek word understanding of constructing or creating, equipping something. There are New Testament portions that use this term in describing the building of the tabernacle and even Noah's Ark. Hebrews chapter 9 and 1 Peter chapter 3 also use this form of the Greek word in talking about us as human vessels, bodily homes of God's love and compassion, of his grace. In other words, Mark is telling us as readers that part of the message being given is that we should make ourselves ready to be sent out as vessels through which God's love can enter into human history. Then we have the second use of prepare in verse 3, which is a sense of getting something ready for a big event. This idea is cultural in the sense of sending someone out ahead of the arrival of a king to make the road that he'll travel safe, passable, and clear of anything that could harm the arrival. It's in this framework of making something ready in anticipation of something that's going to happen later, by calling us to prepare the way of the Lord, that Mark is challenging us to change our hearts and lives and make ourselves ready to fully receive Jesus today so that we are ready for his return, for his coming. He's calling us to live with transformed hearts and lives, with a sold out, all in desire to follow Jesus, with a willingness to suffer in his name, but with a hope of the glorious future that he has promised. So just within these first few verses, and by using two aspects of the word prepare, Mark is calling us first to make ourselves ready as vessels to receive Jesus, and second, to participate in Christ's life, death, and resurrection. You see, Mark will later tell us within his gospel that Jesus used the same word, prepare, to get ready the Passover meal in Mark 14, verse 15. And it's during that Passover meal that Jesus commanded us to live sacramentally, or as he said, do this in remembrance of me. Living sacramentally is very much Advent as we consider how we are to live in the now while anticipating what is to come. As salvationists, we don't often use the term living sacramentally, but it's in our DNA. It's who we need to be in Christ. Now, sacraments deal with the extraordinary within the ordinary. Sacraments are life gifts that we may take for granted, but God uses them to overwhelm us with his surprising and matchless graces. Sacraments transform our ordinary lives. God gives us extraordinary sacramental things like Christ's saving sacrifice, his inclusive fellowship, his call to discipleship, his continued forgiveness. But God also gives us the sacramental within the ordinary things. like a meal shared with those we love and care about, or a meal shared with a complete stranger or someone who may be ostracized in their life context. But something ordinary like meeting the practical need of a fellow human in Jesus' name. How about a time of public declaration to God's saving and keeping grace through enrollments or dedications? Christ is the one true original sacrament, and he continually invites us to remember his life, death, and resurrection through the ordinary and extraordinary. And as sacramental people, we discover that he is living and at work within our everyday life experiences. And when we recognize this, we celebrate the blessings, the transformation, the reconciliation, and the joy in our own stories by connecting them with the broader story, the reality of Jesus. Together, we are a sacramental community. And as we experience this Advent season together, even though we may be physically apart, we need to be a people engaged within the present. It's healthy to celebrate the goodness of God together. And as we continue to stumble, so to speak, within his continued graces and gifts, we recognize them and corporately give him the glory because he continues to do great things. As we engage within our Advent worship opportunities over the next few weeks, these are truly sacramental community moments as we affirm Christ's presence within them and he receives glory. As we pray for those who will come to us for Christmas gifts, these are truly sacramental moments. Is this making some sense? As we live sacramentally today, we live, as Mark tells us in chapter 1, as preparers, living out the presence of Christ among us right here and right now. To await Jesus' return is to also acknowledge that Jesus is already in our midst because he came the first time and he is the risen Savior of the world. Now, although Mark is the only gospel writer to use the two Greek forms of prepare within one general thought, all the gospel writers agree that the best way to prepare for the arrival of Jesus is to make his paths straight. This terminology or imagery given by Isaiah is repeated in Matthew and Luke, and its idea is throughout John's gospel, so it must be significant. It has to have importance. Essentially, what it's referring to is a common theme throughout the entire scriptures, producing a holy and Christ-centered life. It's a walk focused on maturity within our faith journey. Proverbs 4:25-27 says, "Focus your eyes straight ahead. Keep your gaze on what is in front of you. Watch your feet on the way, and all your paths will be secure. Don't deviate a bit to the right or left. Turn your feet away from evil." When we lived in Huntsville, Ontario, prior to becoming Salvation Army officers, we had a lot line on our property at home that wasn't fully parallel. It veered to the left on one end, and it wasn't something that I would think about until I had to mow the lawn, because if I didn't look at a certain fixed point, like a fence post, the line would be off, and either I was on my neighbor's yard or I was not mowing fully on mine. I had to stay focused in order to mow a straight line. This is very much what the writer in Proverbs and Isaiah are talking about with our Christian journey. Since we're prone to sin, we're susceptible to veering off our journey of holy living, leaning into the left or swerving to the right. We're unable to walk a straight line on our own. There's no doubt about it. We need external cues. We must rely on the Spirit's leading in order to make our paths straight. That's good advice for this Advent. If we want to walk a straight path, we need to stop strictly focusing on ourselves. We need to stop looking at the ground and not turn around to only see where we came from. The only way to walk a straight line is to focus on the one who is ahead of you. If only we can fix our eyes on Jesus, making our paths straight, then and only then will our lives reflect him and make ourselves fully ready for his return. Only then will others see Christ in us and through us. Hebrews 12:12-14 says, "So strengthen your drooping hands and weak knees. Make straight paths for your feet so that if any part is lame, it'll be healed rather than injured more seriously. Pursue the goal of peace along with everyone, and holiness as well, because no one will see the Lord without it. Well, this is certainly an Advent message that we've heard today from Mark. We need to slow down and be present in our current situations. The truth Mark gives us in verses 2 and 3 is that we need to be doubly prepared. We need to allow the inner work through God's Holy Spirit to change our hearts. Now, we've provided you with sermon discussion questions on our Advent series website. These are for you to download and use in your personal devotions, or perhaps you'll find a way to use them in your small group or at home with your family. But let me just leave two of them with you today as you reflect on how to apply today's message and make the preparations necessary to allow Christ to visit you again this Advent season. The first question is this: how do you need to slow down and pay more attention to your own spiritual preparations this Advent? And second, what parts of your life need to be made straight today? What do you need to focus on in order not to deviate to the right or the left? May we be people of repentance within this Advent season and confess the things that are not in line with the straight path of righteousness. May we be vessels ready to receive the hope and salvation that God desires us to have through his Son, Jesus. Also, may we sense sacramental moments in the ordinary and the extraordinary. May our lives in Christ be enriched because we invite him into our every day and every moment. You know, it would be easy to just let this Advent season fly by. We're busy enough. We're complacent enough in our faith. But Christ wants to do even more within us. So let's pay attention, let's slow down, and allow the incarnate one to be the amazing Savior that he is.
Refining flame, all that is mine. resigned, struggles are quelled. Clay on the wheel am I, nothing withheld. Master, I yield to thee, crumble.
Friends, thank you for starting your Advent journey with us today here at Guelph Citadel Online. Don't forget that you can download your Advent devotional guide as well as weekly discussion questions at our Advent series website, guelphsa.ca/advent2020. We pray that the resources that have been prepared for you will in turn help you to prepare the way for Christ to do something amazing in your life over the next few weeks. And remember to visit our online giving page at guelphsa.ca/give, where you can participate in the act of giving your tithes and offerings. Links to that and to our sermon series page are in the description below. Finally, if you have not signed up for your Christmas kettle shifts yet for this year, please make sure that you visit guelphsa.ca/christmaskettles or email kettles@guelphsa.ca and get your shifts booked. We want to make sure that we fill as many kettle shifts as possible. Now, would you pray with me? Lord, how we must try your patience. We rush through the seasons of our lives as though we had a mighty schedule to keep. We plot out our days minute by minute, crowding each moment with tasks, stresses, and pressures. Help us bind ourselves to you, loving God. Help us to slow down and reflect on the many ways in which you bless us. Let us drink deeply of your peace. Remind us again of the most precious gift of all, the gift of loving relationship between you and your creation. May we cherish the people and the peaceful moments you offer to us. As we lift before you our joys and concerns, so lift our spirits to remember that you are always with us, offering your healing touch and your compassionate care. Help us to place our trust in you, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
To